Good afternoon, everybody. Like I said, second run of our Universe 10 introduction today. We did one at 8 o'clock this morning in Amsterdam for the eastern part of the world. This one is targeted to Europe and the United States, but everybody is free to join at their most convenient time, of course. Sitting here with together with Michael Taylor and with Christy Hillebrink, Mike and Christy are watching the chat. So at any time you can ask your questions through the chat, and every once in a while we will pause and see if we can summarize the questions and answers. So let's kick off for the Universe 10 introduction. I'd like to pick your imagination for a little while by starting with this slide. Imagine having always driven traditional cars with traditional dashboards like the one in the picture. Two big dials in front of you, two smaller dials, a steering wheel, center console with your entertainment, your radio, your heater, etc. Wonderful car, works fine, driven it for years, fantastic. So imagine then one day a new revolutionary car arrives with a new revolutionary dashboard, like the one in the picture. Not mentioning any names, but you will get the picture. What are you going to do? Will you stay with the traditional car, or will you explore the new car? Stay with the traditional car because, if it's not broken, don't fix it. And we've always done it this way. Or are you willing to explore the new dashboard of the new car because it's more productive? And at this moment in time, this still seems like a choice and a T-junction. But universe-wise, the new road will be the future road, hence this picture. So let's take a look at the Universe 10, the Universe 10 IDE, and look at the new developer. There are some concepts that I would like to highlight you to you. Beginning with development objects and the main development objects. Universe has long had the concept of development objects and runtime objects, but Universe 10 introduces the concept of main development objects. Development objects are application definitions for logical units such as components, fields, properties, messages, variables, and so on. During the build process, development objects are compiled into executable runtime objects and libraries, which can be packaged into archives for immediate deployment. Main development objects are logical aggregations of development objects that are treated as a logical unit for editing and version control. Main development objects include modeled entities, components, and type libraries. Each main development object has an associated editor that is used to edit both the main object and its subobjects. Another concept, modeled objects and derived objects. Modeled objects are development objects that can be inherited by other development objects, which are typically created using the modeled objects. Derived objects inherit from modeled objects. Thus, a component entity that is created using a modeled entity is a derived entity. In previous versions of Universe, only objects belonging to the application model were occasionally referred to as modeled objects. In Universe 10, the term has been expanded and made more consistent. Modeled objects now consist of first modeled entities and fields, second modeled properties, and third modeled components. The modeled entities and fields, entity and field definitions that define the data that application accesses, as well as non-database objects such as reusable buttons. Modeled properties, these are the named values of selected entity and field properties, such as the field interface, field layout, and field syntax properties. In Universe 9, they were known as templates. The modeled components. These are components that are used to create other components with the same component level properties and proc script. In Universe 9, they were known as component templates. The application model no longer exists as a separate object. Instead, it's a mandatory part of the modeled entity name and identifies the entity's namespace. However, the term application model can still be used to refer to a collection of modeled objects that share the same namespace. Another concept, templates and palettes. Templates are development objects that can be copied to create new development objects. Once they are copied, there is no link between the original template and the object that it's based on. If the template is changed, objects that were created with a template do not inherit the change. In Uniface 9, the term templates was used for a variety of objects, some of which were copied, like the field templates, and others that were inherited, like component and property templates. In Uniface 10, the terms have been changed to make this distinction clear. An object that is reused rather than copied is a modeled object and is made available to other objects in the Model tab of the resource browser. An object that is copied to create new objects is a template and is made available in the Templates tab of the resource browser. Uniface 10 provides a rich set of templates that you can use to explicitly create new objects. It's also possible to define and use your own templates, which can be used instead of or in addition to the ones provided by Uniface. In Uniface 9, a similar mechanism known as the Uniface defaults was implicitly used to create all new objects. Definitions in the defaults could be customized to suit your own requirements, but it was not possible to define an alternative set of default templates. This is now possible. Uniface 10 also introduces the concept of a palette, which is main development object that serves as a container for templates. Another concept is projects. Projects are main development objects used to create and organize other main development objects. In this release of Uniface 10, projects are used to create new modeled entities, components, type libraries of snippets, and include scripts and other projects. Another concept are the libraries. In previous versions of Uniface, libraries were untyped, meaning that a library contained a heterogeneous collection of different types of runtime objects, such as messages, menus, and global proc scripts. Untyped libraries are still used for global objects, descriptors, and translation tables. Uniface 10 introduces the concept of typed libraries, which can contain only one type of object or resource. For example, a snippet library only contains code snippets. In this release, typed libraries are used for include scripts, formerly known as include procs, for snippets, and for model properties. Typed libraries of different types may have the same name, which is treated as a shared namespace when referenced by dollar variation. So, the new Uniface 10 IDE. It contains new editors. New editors are provided for creating projects, entities, components, and libraries of include script and code snippets. These editors are non-modal, so it's possible to have many objects open for editing at the same time and switch between them by simply clicking a tab. The new Uniface 10 IDE has code containers. Code containers, the code of components, entities, fields, and application shells is now organized into one or two code containers in which all proc script modules, including triggers, are declared procedurally. In Uniface 9, code was organized into many trigger containers that implicitly declare the trigger. However, some triggers, such as local proc modules, operations, and extended triggers, were not triggers at all, but simply containers for multiple proc script modules. This new organization makes module declaration and inheritance consistent for all proc script modules. About the compiled modules inspector. The new entity and component editors include a compiled modules inspector that enables you to navigate to the script modules that are actually compiled into the component, no matter where they are defined. This makes it much easier to debug the code. About triggers, all triggers are explicitly defined in a script code container using a trigger proc script command. As a result, the terms standard triggers and extended triggers no longer have a meaning. When discussing triggers, it's more useful to distinguish between system triggers, which are executed in response to system events, and interactive triggers, which are fired in response to user-initiated actions. The names of many triggers have been changed to better reflect their purpose. For example, the async interrupt trigger is now the receive message, and the get state and set state are now pre-activate and post-activate. The execute trigger is now defined as an exec operation, which better reflects its purpose. On modeled components, in Uniface 10 there are some changes in the properties and behavior of modeled and derived components, formerly known as component templates and attached components. New properties are available for modeled components and generic entities and fields, such as isGeneric, isBound, and BoundTo. Component variables Component variables are now inherited by the derived component. In UniFS 9, these were separate objects that were not inherited. Generic entities and fields are bound to the component entities and fields simply by renaming them. If the new name is the name of the modeled entity or field, it inherits from the modeled object. As a consequence, you can change the binding to a different entity or field. This was not previously possible. In a derived component, it's possible to edit the bound to component property. This enables you to completely break the inheritance to the modeled component or to have it inherit from a different modeled component. This was previously also not possible. On modeled properties. Modeled properties, formerly entity interface templates, field interface templates, field layout templates and field syntax templates. Modeled properties are now created in typed libraries with a fixed name LIB. In UniFS 9, they were defined as independent objects. Component variables. Component variables are now declared procedurally in a variables block in the declarations code container of components. In UniFS 9, they were defined declaratively as a separate object. Global and compile time constants. Global constants are defined in a reserved include script called devparam using the hashdefine directive. Each include script library can contain a devparam proc script for defining global constants. To be truly global for all your UniFS applications, global constants should be defined in the system library. There is no longer a separate editor for defining global constants. The global constants are automatically exported when the parent library is exported. When exporting from UniFS, it's no longer possible to specify constants as an object type for export using $UDExport or the export form. Compile time constants declarations, hash defined directives, in script containers have container visibility or scope, so they are applicable for all triggers, operations, and entries in a script container. In UniFS 9, they had trigger visibility. To narrow the scope to a specific module, or even to a group of modules, you can use the new hash *stardefine and hash *enddefine precompiler directives. About the repository, the UniFS repository is now versioned, and the export and import facilities have been enhanced to ensure that it's not possible to import repository definitions unless they are compatible with the current repository. As a result, the import facilities /imp and $UDImport can no longer be used to import data created by the data conversion facilities such as /cpi and $UDCopy. Many other changes have been made in the repository to reflect the implementation of main development objects and the UniFS IDE. How are we doing on questions, guys? Okay, let's move on to a small overview of the many changes that have been done in UniFS 10, starting with the terminology. For one example, the UDE, the UniFS Development Environment, has been renamed to the IDE, which stands for Integrated Development Environment. Highlighting some changes in PROCSCRIPT inheritance. Prior to UniFS 10, overlay inheritance was used for operations and extended trigger containers, but container inheritance was used for the local proc modules container and standard triggers, which were containers that implicitly declared a trigger. Although not good practice, standard triggers could also contain entries. Two types of module inheritance made the product inconsistent and unpredictable. In UniFS 10, all PROCSCRIPT modules, including triggers, entries, and operations, now use the overlay inheritance model. Changing the way PROCSCRIPT modules are inherited makes PROCSCRIPT inheritance consistent and predictable. On subtype property inheritance. In UniFS 10, subtype entities can inherit from their subtypes. In UniFS 9, this behavior was simulated to a limited extent by copying values when the subtype was created. For most properties, subsequent changes to supertype properties were not inherited. There's also some discontinued functionality. I'll give you a short overview. The classic deployment mode has has been discontinued, and we've been talking about this for a while already. UniFace itself and the applications you built with UniFace are now delivered as deployment archives, the .ur files. Usasena and Ulana tables have now been removed from the repository, and .dol and .ur files can no longer be generated. The subsystems are discontinued, but projects can be used to organize components into logical modules or subsystems. The component integration workspace is discontinued. It's no longer possible to model signatures and component integration. However, it is still possible to define third-party signatures in the signature editor. The application generation functionality is discontinued. In UniFace 8 and 9, it was possible to automatically generate components based on component subtype entries. And in UniFace 10, you can now do this by using templates and binding. The UniFace deployment environment is discontinued. This tool was also known as the Runtime Administration Environment, the URMA. Short overview on discontinued platforms and databases. Discontinued platforms, OpenVMS, IBM iSeries, and HPX Unix. Discontinued databases, RDB, RMS, and Solid Database. Good alternative for Solid Database could be either your SQLite installation, your default database that comes with your default UniFace installation, or the new Postgres plugin that was delivered already in UniFace 9.7.1. So some changes in trigger names. In UniFace 10, many triggers have been renamed to more accurately reflect the purpose or the event that they respond to. The execute trigger becomes the exec operation. Triggers are now explicitly declared in an object script container using the trigger statement followed by the trigger name. In UniFace 9, only extended triggers were declared in this way. The names of many triggers have been changed. There is a table called UniFace 9 and UniFace 10 trigger names in the UniFace library that documents all these changes. Some changes in proc scripts. New proc script instructions have been added, and existing proc script has been enhanced. So in the new category, the dollar instance layout changed are the component variables. We already mentioned that. Changed is the dollar UD export and the dollar UD import. And we have these new precompiled directives, the hash start define and the hash end define. Continuing on changes, the JavaScript API. First of all, the enhancements from 9.7.02 are ported now into in 10.02, and the UniFace.datastore is a newcomer. This one provides create, update, retrieve, and delete access to browser-based databases. Browser-based databases like Symfony, Zend Framework, Codeigniter, G, and PouchDB. Some changes in properties, actually a lot of changes in properties. The properties inspector of the UniFace IDE enables you to view all the properties of an object at one glance. To ensure that the names of the properties are consistent and their purpose is clear, a number of properties have been renamed, merged, or split. There's a table called New and Changed Properties in the UniFace library that documents them all. Configuration settings. A number of changes have been made to assignment settings, initialization settings, and logicals, mainly to either control the behavior of the new IDE or specify default templates or influence how ProcScript is migrated from UniFace 9 to UniFace 10, or to control the mobile build environment. Some changes in command line switches. Changes have been made to the functionality of some command line switches and subswitches. Example of two new switches are the /tpl and the /plt. Have to do with templates and palettes. An example of two deprecated switches are the /exe. This was a former switch to run a form of the UniFace development environment. This is no longer supported. Another one is deprecated is the slash RMA, and this is of course the switch for the Uniphase deployment environment, the URMA, and this is no longer delivered with Uniphase. So obviously this switch is obsolete. Changes in reciprocity. To support the new Uniphase IDE, some changes have been made to the Uniphase repository. This means that it's not possible to run the Uniphase IDE against a Uniphase 9 repository. The changes have no impact on runtime behavior. Uniphase provides an automatic migration path from Uniphase 9.6 and higher to Uniphase 10, so your data can be easily transferred into the new repository. Changes to the repository are a result of the following. For instance, use of type libraries for include script, code snippets, and model properties. Object properties that have been redesigned. Some properties have been split into two and are stored in separate fields. Others have been merged into one new or change field, and the obsolete field is then deleted. New properties have been added for code containers. Triggers are no longer implicitly declared in a separate container. Additional properties have been added for objects that can be used as templates and are visible in the resource browser. The Uniphase library contains documentation on which repository tables have been changed. This information is probably of interest if you have created your own tools based on the Uniphase 9 repository. In this case, you will need to adapt your tools for the Uniphase 10 repository. So please remember, these are just some of the enhancements. There are a lot more enhancements. Please take a peek at the Uniphase library file to see them all. And the migration, the built-in migration of Uniphase 10 takes care of all these changes in triggers and in inheritance. So there's no need for any recoding on this point. And here's a screenshot of the part in the Uniphase library that addresses all these changes. I clicked it open in the tree, as you see. It's called What's New in Uniphase 10, and the information from my presentation is derived from this part of the Uniphase library. So take a look yourself if you want. How are we doing on questions?
No, we're doing okay with questions. There was one question about whether it's possible to migrate from 9.3 directly to 10. No. Support is from 9.6 or 9.7 to version 10. Basically, the versions which were in support at the time version 10 was released, and obviously going forward with them ones as well.
Yeah, sounds logical. Okay, thank you, Mike.